is the price? We ask the other side. What is the price that you want from these working men and women?
At a time when the richest people are becoming richer, what the Republicans say is the answer is, let us give millionaires and billionaires even more in tax breaks.
And these Republicans that come on this show and say you got to pay for unemployment benefits, but you don't have to offset the $600 billion or so in revenue that you're going to lose, that the CBO says you're going to lose from the tax cuts, are reckless.
The Republican Party is dominated by a absolutely obsessive single idea: slash anything, cut anything, as long as the taxes for our rich patrons come down.
The Republican proposal, as outlined by Congressman Ryan yesterday, also includes over $1.6 trillion in cuts over the next decade for education, Pell Grants, infrastructure, affordable housing, food stamps, food safety, and other vital programs for the middle class, the elderly, the sick, and the children.
So in the face of this kind of poverty, a quarter of our children about to live in poverty, a fifth of our children living in poverty right now as I'm speaking, what's the Republican plan? What do they want to do about this? What is John Boehner and Eric Cantor saying? This is what we need to do. Well, they're pretty specific about it. Kids are in poverty. We need to cut services to low-income children.
The Ryan budget. You know what? It's the blueprint the Republicans have been working towards for over a decade. It's finally on paper, and it is exactly what they want. It's government in a bathtub.
Republican activist Grover Norquist once famously declared that he'd like to shrink the federal government budget down to the point where he could drown it in a bathtub.
Look at their great leader, Grover Norquist. This guy, he has proudly said on the record that he wants to shrink America's government down to the size that he can drown it in a bathtub. He wants to drown America's government in a bathtub. Who talks like that? Who even thinks like that?
And the Ryan plan makes it very clear. The Republicans have now identified the major problem in this country that they see and the solution to that problem. The problem isn't jobs. It isn't the deficit. The problem is the rich don't have nearly enough, and we need to give them a one-third cut in the taxes on their earned income, and we need to pay for that by taking it from the sick, the disabled, the elderly, the poor, from children. That is, from those people with no power, no ability to do anything about their circumstances, because that's our problem, Ed. The rich don't have nearly enough.
And worst of all, this is a vision that says even though Americans can't afford to invest in education at current levels or clean energy, even though we can't afford to maintain our commitment on Medicare and Medicaid, we can somehow afford more than $1 trillion in new tax breaks for the wealthy.
The Paul Ryan budget proposal would bring down the top rate from 35% to 25%. This would make it the lowest level for the very wealthy since 1931, when Herbert Hoover was president.
Ryan wants to be the fiscal conservative poster boy from, ironically, Wisconsin, and yet his entire budget is based on a tax cut for the rich, paid for by the middle class and the poor. I cannot believe that this is where America wants to go. It's a fight that we got to look forward to.
At a time when the middle class is in decline, poverty is increasing, what our Republican friends are saying, let us attack virtually every significant program that improves lives for low-income or moderate-income people.
So be clear about where these cuts are. And I think as most people who've studied this, that two-thirds of the cuts in the Republican plan would be made on the backs of low- and middle-income Americans. That's a fact, okay? And it would continue the tax cuts for the wealthiest Americans.
The broad majority of the public has very reasonable, very mainstream, and compassionate views. They say, don't slash for the poor. No, let's start making the rich pay their due. That's what the public says, the large majority.
We're not going to raise taxes on the very people that we expect to reinvest in our economy and to help grow jobs.
When asked about the best way to reduce the deficit, a full 81% of Americans favor a surtax on those earning over $1 million.
It's counterintuitive to believe that you increase taxes on those individuals and entities you're expecting to create jobs.
If the top 1%, if they were the job creators, based on what this is right here, hell, we ought to have record employment, not record unemployment. You see, they've been lying to us for years about how the job creators are going to reinvest their tax dollars back into the economy.
Trickle-down economics is basically this. You cut tax rates for the richest Americans, therefore the richest Americans have more. They have more money in their pockets. Therefore, they have more money to spend and invest. And as they spend and invest, the effect of rich people's good fortune and rich people's spending trickles down to everybody else in the economy. A rising tide lifts all boats, right? That was the idea. That was the plan. That did not happen.
$240 billion in tax breaks for corporations, $36 billion in tax breaks for small businesses, increase in productivity, 42% over the last 10 years. But do you think there's any increase in the minimum wage? No.
I think on the economy, I mean, the Republicans, what they're offering gives snake oil a bad name.
The question is, do we move toward a balanced budget on the backs of the weakest, most vulnerable people in our country, on the backs of the poor, the children, the elderly, the disabled? That's one way you can do it.
Some will argue we should not even consider ever raising taxes, even if only on the wealthiest Americans.
What about you, sir? Is there reluctance from members of your party when it comes to dealing with the Bush tax cuts and maybe spreading the pain?
Well,
How do you feel about it?
Yeah, I don't think we have a problem in this country because we tax too little. I think it's because we spend too much.
Now, keep in mind, tax bills are the lowest they've been since the 1950s.
For the third year in a row, Americans are paying less in federal taxes than they did under George W. Bush. Pause. Did you get that? You're paying less taxes under Obama than Bush.
You have 50% almost that don't pay taxes. They are benefiting from this redistribution of wealth of people's lives.
You know what?
It's politically
not accurate.
It's not accurate. So let's go after the rich guys.
That's only if you're talking about income taxes. If you're talking about payroll taxes, that is just not accurate.
People pay
a huge amount in payroll taxes that you're not taking into account here at all.
What we tend to forget when we talk about taxes is that most middle-class, working-class people are already taxed enormously. The sales taxes in most states have gone up. Taxes that we call payroll taxes that deal with Social Security and unemployment insurance, those payroll taxes, FICA, have actually gone up. 80% of American workers pay more in payroll taxes than they do in income taxes.
As you say, and Senator McConnell says, the answer is to extend the Bush tax cuts. But let's take a look at the cost here. Extending just the tax cuts for the wealthy would cost $678 billion over 10 years. Extending all the tax cuts would cost $2.9 trillion. That will explode the deficit.
Another way to get the deficit under control is to raise taxes on the super rich, the top 1%, earning over $500,000 a year.
Or do you ask for shared sacrifice? Do you say to the wealthiest people in this country, do you say to the largest corporations in this country, you know, you're part of America too, and you've got to help us get out of this deficit crisis?
And when they do poorly, they should not be expected to pay much back in the form of taxes. But when they do well, they should.
The corporate profits last quarter were the highest in 60 years, coming in about $1.7 trillion just in a quarter. Corporations are sitting with about $1.9 trillion on their books.
My most recent column about this topic, I pointed out how we've got earnings at record levels. Companies have loads of cash. They've been using that cash to pay for mergers, to boost dividends, to have higher share buybacks, and even give big bonuses to their fat cat CEOs.
The corporate sector, well, their profits shot up a record 28% in the third quarter. At the same time, they only spent 7.6% more on employee compensation.
But when they do well, they should. You do. That's simple. That's fair. That's fair. You do well in America, you should do well by America. That's just fair.
The Paul Ryan Republican budget includes $40 billion in taxpayer subsidies for the oil industry. ExxonMobil today announced that its profits this past quarter were the second highest profits ever recorded for any company in any industry ever in the history of the world. They were first, too. Now they've come in second.
Yeah, when I go to get gas now, and it cost me $60 the other day to fill up my wife's tank, and I think we're giving away $4 billion of our money to these oil companies, it's insanity, right?
My friends, Washington, in my opinion, is totally broken. If there was ever a vote to pay attention to, it is this one. And this number says it all. 74% of the American people support eliminating tax credits for big oil and gas companies.
You know, Mr. Speaker, there's a huge gulf between Washington, D.C. and the American people.
Exxon made $10.7 billion in profit in 3 months, which means that since I started this segment, Exxon has made this much money, that many dollars in profit.
Last night, the Senate failed to pass a bill that would have stripped big oil companies of multi-billion annual tax subsidies. The vote, of course, fell short of the 60 votes needed because of a Republican filibuster.
Now, ExxonMobil reported the largest quarterly profit for a corporation in the history of the world.
Let's take a look at oil company prosperity. You see, over the last decade, the top five oil companies, they have raked in some big bucks, $900 billion in profits. The number one profit taker is ExxonMobil, coming in at a cool $309 billion.
$1,400 a second, $83,000 a minute, $5 million an hour. They make $5 million an hour, 24 hours a day, just in profit.
And I think we're giving away $4 billion of our money to these oil companies. It's insanity, right? So, but look, the reason you are is because the Republicans keep blocking it, right? That's just the reality of it. They do it over and over again. Some Democrats as well, but the entire Republican Party.
It's an opportunity to say that a government which borrows more than 40 cents of every dollar it spends is not sustainable and very much needs to change its ways.
Center for American Progress finds the 48 senators who sided with big oil received over $21 million in career oil contributions, while 52 senators who sided with the American people received only $5.4 million in contributions. Big difference, isn't it?
The largest quarterly profit for a corporation in the history of the world last quarter of last year, $9 billion.
Now think about this. You make record profits and you get some help from the government.
You know, they're dealing with tough times. They're struggling to pay their bills.
Today, the Wall Street executives, the crooks on Wall Street, whose actions resulted in the severe recession that we are in right now, the people whose actions, illegal actions, reckless actions, have resulted in millions of Americans losing their jobs, their homes, their savings. Guess what? After we bailed them out, the CEOs today are now earning more money than they did before the bailout.
Year before that, we were in the heels of a financial crisis. We had Wall Street crashing around us. We had banksters walking off with millions and billions, asking for trillions in bailouts. What did the Republicans want to do? They wanted to stop the efforts of the Democrats to reform Wall Street and prevent anybody from doing any investigations of what happened.
And they didn't pay any taxes in the U.S. last year. None. They pay a lot of taxes around the world, but not in the United States.
And they look to Washington, and they see politicians who can't stop spending money, their money.
If you're spending more money than you're taking in, you need to spend less money.
This isn't rocket science.
President Obama spoke about this shameful Senate vote.
That's why I was so disappointed yesterday when Republicans in Congress voted to keep handing $4 billion a year in taxpayer subsidies to oil and gas companies at a time when they are making tens of billions of dollars of profits each. Huge profits while you're struggling to fill up your gas tank. It has to stop.
Is it about fairness? You damn right it is.
We actually gave them a tax refund because of the loopholes in the tax law. That's called a tax expenditure.
Listen, we're broke. And we need to stop the out-of-control spending spree that's going on in Washington, D.C.
We need to quit borrowing.
We're borrowing money to give to the ExxonMobil Corporation, which had a $9 billion profit by gouging consumers in America.
They make in profit $119 million a day, in profit, every day, including Sundays. Plus, they also make some of your money, too, on top of that, as a taxpayer subsidy, just in case.
If you look at what happened to the American budget over the last 20 or 30 years, the culprit is obvious. We have dropped corporate taxes. We have dropped taxes on the rich.
Republicans won't even consider increasing taxes on the rich. They say it's off the table.
And since the beginning, the majority leader and myself, along with Senator McConnell and Senator Kyle, have been clear. Tax hikes are off the table.
Two polls released this week show, as they have before, that most Americans favor increasing taxes on the rich. No news there. A Marist McClatchy poll found 64% support raising taxes on those who make more than $250,000. That's the top tax bracket. Only 33% opposed it.
First of all, raising taxes is going to destroy jobs. And if you raise taxes on the people that we need to grow our economy and to hire new workers, guess what? They're not going to do it if they have to pay higher taxes to the federal government.
David, thanks for your time tonight. Let's get right to it. Start with the basics. These tax cuts did not prevent high unemployment. So how would continuing them actually go to reduce it?
Well, they won't. They won't create a single job.
Now, individual income taxes as a percentage GDP have dropped from 9.7% in 2001 to 6.2% in 2010. Folks, that's a 36% drop. Numbers haven't been that low since World War II. Income tax payments this year will be almost 13% lower than in 2008. Corporate taxes will be down by a third. In fact, as a percentage of the economy, taxes are at their lowest level since, wait for it, 1950. I don't know if you know this, but that was 61 years ago.
10 years ago, you made a mistake.
You gave tax cuts to millionaires like me.
And me.
And me.
You decided our country needed less money.
And millionaires like me needed more.
Now millionaires
have more money.
And our country has less.
I'm a little puzzled about what my friend and pal and colleague Dagan said about how this country can't afford higher taxes. We had much, much higher taxes in the entire period from 1941 until 2001. And we did just fine for most of that time, so I'm kind of puzzled about that.
And taxes over the past couple of decades are nothing compared to what they were throughout most of the 20th century. Today, the top marginal tax rate in America is 35%. Now, let's put that in some sort of historical perspective. In 1944, the top tax rate was 94%, and it stayed at 91% or higher for a 13-year stretch from 1950 to 1963. Now, remember, those are the years that a lot of people, including the conservatives, believe were the golden age of America.
If you go back to the 1940s, here's what you discover, that the federal government got 50% more money year after year from corporations than it did from individuals. For every dollar that individuals paid in income tax, corporations paid $1.50. If you compare that to today, here are the numbers. For every dollar that individuals pay to the federal government, corporations pay 25 cents. That is a dramatic change that has no parallel in the rest of our tax code.
You notice the American public isn't asked by Congress or the president these days, but the American public speaks clearly in opinion survey after opinion survey. It says, the rich have had a free ride. The corporations have been running our country.
And a Washington Post ABC News poll found 72% of Americans support raising taxes on the top wage earners, with only 27% opposing it.
Wrong. Democrats want to raise taxes to get us, you know, to get some cuts involved. Where are you with this?
No tax increases.
Zero.
Zero.
Off the table.
I've made it clear to the president, we're not going to raise taxes.
I say that at a time when the tax burden on the wealthy is at its lowest level in half a century, the most fortunate among us can afford to pay a little more.
Less money for roads to transport our products.
For high-speed internet to build our technology companies.
Science research, education.
For universities and research to spark our innovation.
Less money for everything America needs.
And more money for millionaires.
But what about the rich? What about the people in the top tax bracket? The same poll broke down the numbers for those who make more than $100,000 a year. Now, the top tax bracket is much higher than $100,000 a year, but what we have is information on those making more than $100,000 a year. And again, a majority of them, 61% of them, say people in the top bracket should pay more taxes.
I don't need another tax cut.
Rich people are not the cause of a robust economy. They're the result of a robust economy.
The Small Business Administration lent money to my company, which then made me millions.
I've been able to help start companies that create things that people want, but I couldn't have done that if I wasn't educated at public schools and libraries.
Yet the top 1% have been taking home almost a quarter of total national income, and they have half of all the wealth of this country.
Think about that. In the last decade, the average income of the bottom 90% of all working Americans actually declined. Meanwhile, the top 1% saw their income rise by an average of more than a quarter of $1 million each.
We see it on Wall Street, record profits yesterday of J.P. Morgan. Is it really going to be that we let the rich have more wealth, higher share of national income than they've ever had in our nation's history, and walk away with that?
Well, Jeffrey, I think we ought to celebrate that success.
We celebrate it when people are suffering. 90% of the public suffering, though, Governor.
But that's the American dream.
It's not for 90%, it's the American nightmare.
Think about that. Seriously, how can Republicans in good conscience argue that slashing benefits for the poor is the moral thing to do, and that Christian values dictate that we give more and more money to oil, to bank companies, and to defense contractors instead? It makes no sense.
They want to give people like me a $200,000 tax cut that's paid for by asking 33 seniors each to pay $6,000 more in health costs.
They are tools. It's that simple. They're tools. You know, George Carlin said back in 2005, they've made us ignorant, these people who own the country, they've made us ignorant and they've made us poor. And now the next thing they want to do is to take away our Medicare and our Social Security. He said that in 2005, and it's taken 6 years to make it obvious that that's true.
More income and wealth is now concentrated at the very top in America than we've seen in 80 years. I mean, we have the top 1% is taking home over 20% of total national income.
That's who needs to pay less taxes?
In 1980, the top 1% of Americans earned wages of about $110,000 a year. By 1990, after about 10 years of Reaganomics, boing, the top 1% had seen their wages rise by 80%. Trickle-down economics, though, right? What's good for the rich is good for all of us, right? Not quite. Here's the average wages of the rest of the country in 1980, and here's what happened for the rest of the country after about 10 years of Reaganomics. Flat. A whopping 3% rise in wages in 10 years. The richest people see their fortunes go up like the Matterhorn. Everybody else, feh, nothing.
Mr. President, it is now a 10 after 5. On the fifth day that the Senate has been considering raising the minimum wage from $5.15 to $7.25 over a two-year period.
In 1985, the top 5% of the households, the wealthiest 5%, had net worth of $8 trillion, which is a lot. Today, after serial bubble after serial bubble, the top 5% have net worth of $40
trillion. Oh, my God.
And top 5% have gained more wealth than the whole human race had created prior to 1980.
From 1980 to 2005, 80% of all income went to the top 1%.
Between the years 1980 and 2005, 80% of all new income generated in this country went to the richest 1%.
Here's another number, one politicians don't talk about so much. 80. Out of every $100 that the nation's collective income increased between 1980 and 2005, $80 went to the people who needed it least, the richest 1%.
Let me put that in terms that even you fat-ass teabaggers, sorry, can understand.
Hey, let's talk about that.
Say 100 Americans get together and order 100 slice pizza. The pizza arrives, they open the box, and the first guy takes 80 slices.
And by the way, since 1979, for those of you at home that don't know this, the top 1% have nearly quadrupled their income, quadrupled, whereas the rest of us have stayed right about even. And look at that. In the 1970s, the share of the top 1% for the national income was 9%, nation's wealth. Now it's 23.5%, the highest level it's been since right before the Great Depression.
400 Americans now have amassed more wealth than 50% of the American households combined. 400 people have more than 155 million people combined.
Tell me how the wage earner in America, which is the blue line, and the productivity of the American worker is the green line, and the top income earners of America is the red line. Tell me how that is good for America.
You can't raise taxes on the very people that we expect to invest in our economy and to create jobs.
We have been fed this line for so long that if we keep giving rich people tax breaks, it's going to create all these jobs. We heard that during the Bush administration, and guess what? It didn't pan out. What Harry Reid is talking about here is not covering the whole deficit through tax increases. He's talking about a balanced approach. Right now, revenue is about 15% of GDP. That is a 60-year low.
But what about Republicans? The Washington Post ABC News poll found over half, 54% of Republicans favor raising taxes on that top tax bracket. That's right. Most Republicans, 54% of Republicans support raising taxes at the top bracket.
The people around Washington haven't been listening. You know, the American people say one thing and they see their government do something else.
A national poll from CBS News, Vanity Fair, asked people, what's the first thing you would do to balance the federal budget? 61% said they would raise taxes on the rich.
So tax increases are off the table. And I'm not sure that they've gotten the message yet.
For three decades after World War II, during the greatest economic expansion the world has ever seen, the top rate was always more than 70%. Now it's 35%, and it's only 15% on capital gains, which is how many of the super rich make their money.
Here are a few figures on the Forbes 400. 20 years ago, 1987, it took $220 million to make the list. Now it takes $1.3 billion, about a 6-for-1 increase.
I don't think it's outrageous to ask people who are making a lot of money to pay a little bit higher tax rate.
I mean, the U.S. has created just an incredible system within which my enterprise, all business enterprises, are embedded.
I see no reason not to tax millionaire income more highly than other income.
I mean, you would think that since so many of our corporations refuse to share their earnings through wages, they would at least be patriotic enough to pay America back in the form of taxes.
Shouldn't America's richest citizens pay their fair share?
I mean, they want to repeal. I mean, I want people to hear this. They want to repeal the estate tax, which would provide over a 10-year period $1 trillion in tax breaks to the top 0.3%. You got that? Top 0.3%, the very, very, very wealthy. And then they have the nerve, our Republican friends have the nerve to come back and say, oh, we are really worried about the deficit and the national debt.
In just 2 years, we could raise $91 billion by scrapping the Bush tax cut for the top 2%, another $23 billion by raising the estate tax, and $40 billion by raising capital gains taxes to 20%, the level that they were under President Clinton. By the way, that's still a comically low rate, but even that would do the job. Look, that took me 2 minutes, and I raised $154 billion.
There aren't going to be any tax increases.
Then why would they keep pushing for it in these negotiations?
I'm just not sure they've been dealing with reality.
Republicans, Democrats, independents, the rich, most of the nation agrees that taxing the rich should be part of our national debt solution.
Let me sum it up for you in one word. Overwhelming.
I should be taxed my fair share.
We shouldn't be wallowing in our riches while everybody else is suffering.
For 10 years, Republican leadership have refused to let us get a vote on increasing the minimum wage.
10 years ago, you gave me a tax cut I didn't want and I didn't need.
Fix the mistake you made.
You can't come off just having given tax breaks to people who make $1 million a year and then expect little old ladies are dependent on Social Security to give up something. That's not right.
So to stand before the public and rub raw this anti-tax sentiment, the Republican Party, as much as it pains me to say this, should be ashamed of themselves.
This from Ronald Reagan's old budget director, architect of the largest tax cut in American history?
Cenk, what you got today is somebody like Warren Buffett, one of the richest guys in the world, pointing out that his effective tax rate, that is the real taxes that he actually pays, are lower than his secretary's. And in fact, at 16% is lower than many police officers or teachers or nurses.
In a country that prides itself on equality of opportunity, it is becoming anything but that as the gap between the super rich and the middle class widens in dramatic fashion.
They keep telling you got to cut Social Security and they got to cut your Medicare. When they ask you, the American people, you say, no, raise taxes on the rich. That's the other way to do it. Now I'm asking you, do we live in a democracy or don't we?
The only group standing in the way of that are elected Republicans in Congress. So we know they're not representing their constituents on this issue.
The new Republican majority in the House has shown every sign that they've heard the public on all of this.
And here's what it's about, Jake. If everything is said and done, the bottom line is that what these guys are about is representing the wealthiest people in this country.
This is a time for us to roll up our sleeves and go to work on the people's priorities.
74% said it's time to end subsidies for oil and gas companies. Why won't Congress simply do what the people want?
Tax me.
Tax me.
Tax me.
Tax me.
Tax me.
Tax me because my country, our country, means more than my money.
Why are our politicians ignoring the clear popular will? Unfortunately, there's an answer to that. It's because they're representing the rich donors that got them elected and not you.
The American people don't want us to raise taxes.
What is the price that you want from these working men and women? What cost? How much more do we have to give to the private sector and to business? How many billion dollars more? Are you asking? Are you requiring?
Yeah, it's just a giant zero-sum game. I mean, it's just the middle class who is seeing no increase in income at all, getting squeezed and squeezed and squeezed and squeezed, and losing public services that are vital to them at the same time.
Let's look at what Republicans have done in your body, the Senate. You have blocked lending assistance for small business. You have voted against extending unemployment benefits. You have voted against financial regulatory reform. Is that the way to boost the economy?
50 million Americans have no health insurance today. Republican solution, slash $1.3 billion for community health centers, denying primary health care to 11 million patients. Now, what happens when you're sick, you have no insurance, you don't have any money, you can't go to a doctor? What happens?
They also want to cut money for food safety. Yeah, who needs safe food?
We have the rich enjoying wealth and income levels that they've never seen in history, and then people suffering at the bottom. And the idea that this is going to be done just by cutting programs for the middle class and poor seems to me to be impossible. What kind of country really would it be?
I mean, right now we're at a time of unprecedented child poverty. What do they want to do? They want to cut the programs aimed at preventing child poverty.
If you try to squeeze out a path to budget sustainability or anything like that without revenues, you will have to cut government to the point where it would be unrecognizable. And I'm talking about military, social security, you know, health security, retirement security, education, infrastructure, protection for low-income people. The reason why revenues have to be part of the deal is not because we want things to be balanced or things should be even or we want this and they want that. It's because without revenue, the pressure on spending is so deep that you will cut the floor out from under this economy.
Here's the problem for Republicans. Most Americans want to reduce the deficit, but most Americans absolutely disagree with the way that the Republicans are doing it.
Talking about punishing people who work for
you know what? Hold on.
We're not talking about it.
The Republican posture is that we are only going to do spending cuts. That's it. What we're talking about is a balanced approach.
Right.
We've put Medicare on the table. We've put Social Security on the table. We've put everything on the table, and Republicans are not coming halfway. They're not even coming a quarter of the way.
We have a serious problem. It looked like serious people were making a serious effort to solve it, and then Eric Cantor just has a hissy fit and pouts and screams
because
and cries.
He argued, Eric Cantor, that the Democrats kept saying, the vice president kept saying, you got to increase taxes as well, and the Republicans are saying under no circumstances in this economy will they increase taxes.
Now, Republicans say we absolutely need these cuts because it's the only way to reduce the deficit.
One Republican brave enough to go public is David Stockman, President Reagan's budget director.
Tax cutting is a religion. What do you mean by that?
Well, it's become, in the sense, an absolute.
Perhaps we can see a way forward to ensure that no one gets a tax increase this year.
Something that can't be questioned.
What I want to tell you is that higher taxes won't get anybody hired. It would be a bad idea to raise taxes on any American.
There wouldn't be something that's gospel.
Republicans want trillions in cuts and no tax hikes. Democrats say tax hikes should be included in the mix.
Something that's sort of embedded in the catechism, and so scratch the average Republican today, and he'll say tax cuts, tax cuts, tax cuts.
Cut taxes.
Cutting taxes.
Make the tax cuts permanent.
We've been now, for a decade, living under the theory that reducing taxes creates jobs, especially reducing taxes on billionaires, you know, the job creators, creates jobs. It's not working too well, isn't it?
Last year, we were at a time of historically high unemployment. What did the Republicans want to do? Cut off unemployment insurance.
I think that people at the high end, people like myself, should be paying a lot more in taxes. We have it better than we've ever had it.
The gap between the rich and poor hasn't been this big since 1928, better known as this.
The year before the Great Depression.
The haves are getting more while the have-nots are getting less.
The rich are always going to say that, you know, just give us more money and we'll go out and spend more and then it'll all trickle down to the rest of you. But that has not worked the last 10 years, and I hope the American public is catching on.
America was a country that sort of stayed together historically with great unity on the glue that we all figured if we worked hard and we played by the rules, we'd do better than our parents and they would do better than their parents and our kids would do better than us.
Economists say that is no longer the case in the United States and that we've gone from being one of the most upwardly mobile countries in the developing world to the least.
What is the price that the workers have to pay to get an increase? What is it about working men and women that you find so offensive?
Take a look at this. The blue line shows how much the pay of CEOs has gone up since the 90s. That yellow line at the bottom, well, that's the pay of minimum wage workers, and it has gone down.
I want any Republican to explain how 30 years of wage stagnation and 80% improvement in productivity by workers and the ridiculous growth in income for the top 1% has made this country better. No Republican, I don't think, can do this.
The total wealth of the list in 1987 was then $220 billion. Now it's $1.54 trillion, exactly a 7-for-1 increase. Tax law changes have benefited this group, including me, in a huge way.
Warren Buffett doesn't need another tax cut. Not if we have to pay for it by making seniors pay more for Medicare.
But the Ryan plan is not an amendment of Medicare. It says if you're under 55, you will not get Medicare. That program ends as it has existed. There will be something different. You will have to get private insurance, and the federal government will give you some money towards that private insurance, but obviously not enough. So I don't regard that as a cost saving within Medicare.
Or by cutting kids from Head Start.
The Republicans want to cut the Head Start program. They want to cut the Child Nutrition Assistance program. They want to cut the WIC program, Women, Infants, and Children. They want to cut education, health care, support programs for disadvantaged kids.
Or by taking away college scholarships that I wouldn't be here without.
Everybody in America knows how hard it is for a middle-class family to send their kids to college. Most significant federal program are the Pell Grant programs, making it easier for low- and moderate-income families to afford college. Republican solution, slash $5.7 billion from Pell Grants, which means that over 9 million American students will lose some or all of their Pell Grants. Many of them will not be able to go to college.
I think all the Republicans made it clear, and I think the Democrats understand, that we don't believe lack of revenue is a part of the problem, and so we will not be discussing raising taxes.
Now is the time, in my view, for working families all over this country to stand up and say, enough is enough.
I've also made clear that we are not going to raise taxes on the American people.
This is just think about this for a minute.
We as Republicans are not going to support tax increases.
What these Republicans are about.
In America, freedom is determined by your wealth. If you have money, you write the rules, and then you break them without paying any penalties.
Is it about fairness? You damn right it is.
The government launched a war based on lies, and no one was prosecuted.
Do we live in a democracy, or don't we?
In 2008, Wall Street nearly wrecked the economy, and to this day, millions of people are out of work.
It's a fight that we got to look forward to.
They even bailed them out with taxpayers' money, and no one was prosecuted.
When does the greed stop?